conference organizers, especially Richard Jackson and Rosemary McBride, and all the others, for all the hard work they've put into this conference and for inviting me to speak. I'm thrilled to be here for the first time here in New Zealand, and I've learned a lot so far already. So the question I posed myself for this talk was, what does pacifism contribute to our thinking on acting ethically in the face of violence, aggression, or oppression? And more specifically, as someone who's framed my own previous work in terms of nonviolent action instead of pacifism, I'm particularly interested in exploring the question, what, if anything, do we gain by developing and taking an explicitly pacifist stance, as opposed to simply sustaining a perhaps more contingent commitment to the practice of nonviolent action? So it's a subtle distinction. I realize that I'm interested in exploring this distinction, since I've been inclined to talk about nonviolent action instead of pacifism. So in my exploration, I have a couple of key points of reference which reflect my own personal identity and positioning in the world right now. So the first point of reference for me is my recent experience as a fairly new mother. And it's an experience that's taught me an enormous amount about power and control. I know this is kind of funny, but agency, conflict, difference, and relationship. And any of the mothers or parents in the room will hear some familiar things, I think, in this talk. So following other feminist IR theorists like Ruddick and Cohn, I'm going to examine what maternal thinking, this is a term that Ruddick developed, so the modes of thinking that follow from demands of maternal practice, what that has to add to our understanding of conflict and pacifism. And just to be clear, Ruddick, when she talks about mothers, she includes men possibly in that definition. It's whoever has primary responsibility for child care and child rearing. So the intellectual resources that practice can bring to our thinking about conflict. So my second point of reference stems from the current political moment in the city and state and country where I live. I live in Portland, Oregon, in the United States. And since Trump's election, it's become one of the epicenters of clashes between recently resurgent white supremacist neo-Nazi groups on the right, who are organizing under the guise of free speech. I don't know how much the media is following that over here, but. And so on the one hand, and then on the other hand, the Antifa contingents who oppose them. So anti-fascist activists who, among other forms of anti-fascist organizing, are willing to engage in violence with those on the far right. So it's not unusual to walk down the street in Portland, my city, and see a poster or some graffiti entreating passersby to punch Nazis. It's something you see quite frequently, right? And in addition, in this broader political or polarized context, this past May, a man with inchoate white supremacist sympathies stabbed three men, killing two, on the commuter rail in Portland, after verbally assaulting two young women with an anti-immigrant, anti-Muslim, racist, pro-free speech rant. So I think this context calls out for analysis in the talk on pacifism for a couple of reasons, both because of the arguments in favor of violent confrontation with neo-Nazis and white supremacists, and because of the archetypal nature of this, this commuter rail attack. So it's the very type of case of interpersonal violence that is often used by those suspicious of pacifism to challenge it, right? And again, as Wayne Katie was telling us or mentioning earlier today, of course, there are many types of pacifism, so it's meant to challenge the more absolute version of pacifism, right? So many would argue that one of those bystanders on the train would have been justified in shooting, perhaps killing the perpetrator to prevent him from killing the people that he ended up killing and harming, you know, stabbing the other one who ended up just being injured. And many would also likely extend this analogy to situations of collective violence and warfare, saying that if a state or a non-state armed group engages in an act of aggression against another state or a particular group of people, then the target group or state is justified in using violence in self-defense, or the international community is justified in using violence to intervene on the target's behalf. So these are, as we all know, common sense, this is sort of common sense thinking in international relations, enshrined in international law and just war theory. And even in some corners of post-structuralist ethics. So David Campbell argued in an essay in the early 90s, in reference to the demands of standing in support of difference and otherness, quote, "The act of affirmation of alterity must involve the desire to actively oppose and resist, perhaps depending on circumstances even violently, those forces that efface, erase, or suppress alterity," end quote. So the argument he's essentially making is that ruling out violence would rule out a mode of action that could potentially be necessary for affirming alterity or otherness in particular circumstances, whether against an individual or a group or a state. So in other words, the thinking goes that ethical action may sometimes require us to punch Nazis. So this provides another point of reference for me today in the discussion of pacifism. But before I start talking about some of the implications as I see them of the pacifist stance in these contexts, a little ground clearing is of course in order, because this is a talk about pacifism, and as we all know, it occupies a marginalized position. So as I understand it, there are some three main criticisms or dismissals that are sort of launched against pacifism. The first is that a pacifist position is assumed to be a position of passivity, as we've talked about earlier today. So critics of this sort would argue that pacifism would be wonderful if everyone were on board or played by the rules. But the hard truth is that there are those who are not or do not, whether evil or simply self-serving, and who will simply take advantage of the nonviolent nice guys to get the upper hand. So we've all heard this sort of argument before, particularly with reference to the Nazis, you know, Munich and appeasement, those are common challenges to pacifism. And a subset of this critique, I think, is that nonviolent action might work with democratic or moral adversaries, but not with truly bad guys. And this is actually common in the Antifa literature, where it basically says, talking, et cetera, is fine with some people, but Nazis, you have to take action, by which they mean violent confrontation. So putting aside the dichotomy between, talking equals nonviolence, action equals violence, which is problematic on its own, that's sort of their approach as well. So that's the first sort of criticism or dismissal. The second ones I see it are where more radical critics argue that a pacifist position is inherently conservative because only violence is radical enough to confront certain entrenched or extreme forms of oppression or injustice, and to bring about the necessary revolution. So we obviously see this in Franz Fanon's work on anti-colonial arguments for violent resistance, and also in Antifa's contemporary arguments for physical confrontation with fascists. And then third, pacifists, in their principle of opposition to using violence against anyone, either individually or in wartime, depending on the brand, again, pacifism, even in situations where some people are frightened by violence, they risk abrogating their responsibility to these others through their over-concern for those others. So that's the third main criticism as I see it. And we obviously see this in debates on humanitarian intervention, in cases where a government is terrorizing its own civilians through mass killing and other atrocities. But it also emerges again in the context of Antifa, when it's argued that it's necessary to protect unarmed activists against white supremacists and neo-Nazis. So, these criticisms all depend, I argue, on misguided assumptions about, first of all, the utility of violence. I think these are things that we generally take certain things about violence as for granted and don't ask the necessary questions about it as a form of effective action. So, underlying these critiques or these criticisms is the idea that somehow violence could do better. That it's a reliable tool for effectively deterring or stopping aggressor, for dismantling unjust power structure, or for protecting targeted populations. That's our underlying assumption when we argue that violence is necessary, right? And one reason it comes across as so reliable is because, and this is the thinking of the late now Dustin L. Towse, is that violence, quote, produces some things with utter certainty, e.g. dead bodies, pain, screams, end quote. And it's these immediate tangible effects that sort of trick us into reading its overall efficacy as makes us feel like we're doing something. There are these immediate, tangible results to these actions, right? But of course, those dead bodies don't translate automatically into the political results that we want, right? And we can never actually be completely certain about what the outcomes of violence will be. Its effects are unpredictable. So Hannah Arendt argues this. Its effects are unpredictable, as are the effects of all political action, and therefore its ability to succeed in defending, resisting, or protecting is actually no more reliable than other forms of action. We don't actually know what the outcomes are going to be. Another reason I think that we tend to think that violence is more reliable and more decisive derives from the assumption, which stems from the domestic analogy, that military actions cannot operate solely via brute force, and thereby somehow forces opponents into submission or surrender, leaving them with no further room for deliberation or choice or alternate course of action. So this domestic analogy, I think, is often the prism through which we think about war, and we think about what military action does. So just as someone is attacked by a thug in an alleyway, or attacked by an assailant on a commuter rail, to take my example earlier, just as that target might use brute force in self-defense to disable or kill the immediate threat to her life or his life, so too can an army similarly just use brute force in self-defense to disable or kill an invading army with the same finality and decisiveness with which the victim in the alleyway or on the commuter rail rids herself of a single attacker. So there's this one-to-one sort of transfer of logic that we tend to do without realizing that there's a real difference between those two scenarios. Because in the case of intergroup and collective violence, everything hinges, and this is, again, this is Hal's thinking, everything hinges on how one's violence affects those opponents who remain after their compatriots have been killed or maimed. So when you're working with collectives, you're not actually, in most cases, obliterating the entire army at once, right? You kill some of them. What matters is how the others who remain react. So does it increase or decrease their will to continue fighting? Does it coerce them or does it energize them? So barring, as I said, a wholesale obliteration of its entire military capability, the opponent group is not actually forced into a particular course of action, retreat or surrender. Rather, they decide how to proceed based on a mix of pressures and motivations. And the results, therefore, are not automatic. So rather, even though military action certainly affects the opponent's military capability, I'm not denying that at all, it more crucially, I argue, influences the will of the opponent group, and therefore its effects can be unpredictable. Even if there's a clear disparity in military capability between the two sides. So we can think of lots of cases, right? Vietnam, Iraq, in some ways, and lots of different cases where the mighty, you know, U.S. military was not able to clearly succeed. And in fact, one's use of violence against the opponent can even bring about the opposite results from that intended, emboldening members of the opponent group, reinforcing the psychological and discursive conditions that make their own violence possible, and therefore strengthening the resolve to fight harder and longer. So these are some of the assumptions about the utility of violence that I think we need to start rethinking and challenging. And then second, I think these major criticisms of pacifism also rely on misguided assumptions about nonviolent action as well. So just as a reminder, that it's passive and or ineffective against opponents who are not nice, that it maintains the status quo, and that it fails to protect vulnerable others. So to respond to each one of these in turn, first, as all of us know, nonviolent action is just that. It's action, an effective action at that. I probably don't need to remind most of you about Tenowith and Stefan's 2011 findings that nonviolent action is twice as likely to bring about its goals than violent resistance is. And those are some maximalist, some one could argue radical goals, so maybe they don't go far enough, but certainly they are radical in sort of the old sense. They're not reforming as much as they are like upending a regime. And so claims that renunciation of violence necessarily equals passivity simply don't hold water, I think, for this empirical work. Furthermore, nonviolent action action does not depend on the goodwill of adversaries and their ultimate persuasion. So persuasion is certainly one of the mechanisms by which nonviolent action can work. We know that it can be very powerful in that way, but it also has coercion at its disposal. We all know that the analysis of power is central to the thinking behind nonviolent resistance campaigns. So it can, it works, it has worked, it can work against unsavory opponents who don't share our moral values. Therefore, nonviolent action and therefore pacifism does not require everyone to be on board or to play by the rules to work. Nonviolence can meet violence and still win. Second, and on a very much related note, nonviolent action resists various forms of injustice and brings about radical change, again, vastly more effectively than violent resistance does. So I think for all the reasons I just mentioned, it's also simply inaccurate to equate violence radical action, resistance, and then depending on violent action as implicit with the status quo. I think that just doesn't make sense, even though those are very powerful connotations of violence being radical, right? We all sort of felt that or heard that before. And one could even argue nonviolent action is more radical because it's not using the master's tools to dismantle the master's house, to use other words, right? It's capable of creating something wholly new. Especially with the constructive program and those forms of nonviolence that are trying to create new power structures. And third, and finally, this is my last sort of response to the critiques. Despite the assumption that renunciation of violence leaves those targeted by other people's violence vulnerable, there are actually protective mechanisms associated with nonviolent action that are often difficult to see due to our deep-seated associations between weapons and protection. So security forces generally have greater difficulty firing on unarmed activists than they do on armed rebels. And armed or unarmed nonviolent resistance movements often are proactively thinking about ways to engage with those security forces so that they can flip them to their side so they can disobey orders. And of course, security forces do fire on nonviolent movements. We know that. Nonviolent movements often expect it. But by and large, civilians are less vulnerable when a resistance movement is nonviolent than when it is violent. And I think that's a really important point that's sort of hard to have sink in. But there has been empirical research, again, Chenoweth and Rakowski in 2016 did research on this and found that armed resistance movements were